श्रीमती रमन जाय नमः। It has been a very great subject of debate for everybody, being scientific or spiritual or social, in whatever may be the context, about the composition of each and every entity of the world. And there are innumerable interpretations for that, and I want to just project only one angular or dimensional aspect of scrutiny, which is to consider everything as jnana, that which is composed of material for knowledge, to be a source of knowledge, to be a person or viewer or observer of knowledge, to be the fruit of knowledge, which has been explained in the shastras as pramada, prameya and pramana, the tools of knowledge, gaining knowledge, and the purpose of knowledge, and that thing that is being interpreted or analyzed or identified by one's scrutiny or vision. Pramana is the tool of knowledge by which we can get the real knowledge, and pramada is a person who is a blemishless tool, who can understand that knowledge without any sort of spot or maculation. And third thing is prameya, that which is meant for being known. So everything is on the basis of knowledge, irrespective of the divisions, the depths and dimensions. Even if there is a thief, he will be interested in knowing how to make that burglary without being caught. And if even being caught, he will be very much analyzing the process by which he can be bailed out. So irrespective of the novelty, irrespective of the nobility, irrespective of the various other circumstantial variations of the society, everybody is very much oriented with knowledge, gaining blemishless, infallible information by which they can be very clear and precise in their knowing and execution. So everything is knowledge based. So the science of knowledge is known as epistemology, which has the cradle, the cot and throne in India. What is the greatness of India? That India is the real birth center, real ambrosia of the knowledge, real and perfect, all enduring, multi-dimensional, multifaceted knowledge that has originated only in time. So whenever we come to the genetics, there is the evolution of living beings, everything is subjected to growth. You know that whenever you distinguish the living and non-living creatures, we used to say that living things, they grow, and non-living things, they don't. What is that growth? Growth consists of two divisions. One is biological growth by mitosis and meiosis, which naturally happens in all living beings. Second is the psychological growth. Psychological growth is restricted with people on the basis of their spatial evaluation, on all other, starting from amoeba, ending with all other species which are subhuman in nature. The psychological growth is very much limited on the basis of their need of the survival, their flourishing, reproduction, and other very basic essentials. Whenever in human beings, there are three stages. One is that type of psychological expansion in the form of intellect, which is required for a person's survival. Second is the expansion which deals with collective survival in the form of social enhancement and scientific development. Third thing is that type of psychological growth into the form of fundamental knowledge or the study of the primordial or the primeval factor of the world by which a person's emancipation or liberation is done. So the first expansion is known as society, second expansion is known as science, and third expansion is known as spiritualism, by which a person can understand. That's what I already used to say in civilization's interpretation. Civilization is the mature stage of any human being where he can understand those who are around him, beyond him and above him. Those who are with him are surrounded, those people are considered in society. That which is beyond him is understood in science. That which is above everything is understood in spiritualism. A tri-dimensional clarity of getting an ideology about all of these things and also the practical methodology is said to be civilization, and implementation of that civilization is what we call culture. So whenever we consider it into growth, real growth is understanding about one's own self and the mutuality or the symbiosis that exists between an individual with the collective survival mechanology or mechanism. So this type of knowledge is based on various things. You know about the history and evolution of science. History that deals with three various expansions of science that is going on now. One is insufficiency of science, second is inefficiency of science, third is mismanagement of science. The first thing is, when human beings, they started involving into scientific pursuits, exemplifications, experiments and analytical studies as well as the fruits. At first they started that the science is totally inefficient because of lacking of advantage of the tools. Then the advantage of the technical era came. Then due to the evolution of various species, expansion of various problems and also the population issues, then they consider that it is insufficient. The third problem now we are facing is mismanagement of resources of the same science. We are into dealing with a new dimensional study of science in which the science has endeavored in the process of correcting its own mistakes. Number one, in order to expand the limitations that it has nailed on itself, it is going to deal with the process of getting connected sciences and advanced sciences for its own benefit. For example, if there is statistics, for getting more implementation value, you have to go for applied statistics. So in each and everything, applied, advanced, para, these prefixes are included. For example, parapsychology. So science has come to the level of understanding its mistakes, shortcomings, mismanagement and malpractices, so that it has demanded a reasonable, rational of understanding, something which is beyond human rational, that is, it needs the helpful embrace of philosophy, logic, spiritualism and realization. That is the present era, wherein by we have to clearly point out essentially what is the practical dimension of philosophy. Philosophy consists of various things: fictional, fallacious, narrative, depictive, innumerable illustrious and non-illustrious and experimental and experiential visions of knowledge is there. We have to clearly deal with the empirical dimension of a conglomerated joint venture of a bilateral communion of science and spirituality in this era, and we have to start with only the process of knowledge which is being properly constituted, configured and complemented with an institutional and rational basis. That type of knowledge only will come for rescue for a long run. All the other things are just ear fillers, mind fillers and interim solace givers, which will not come for any practical issue in our long run. So within the short span of the time given, I want to present everything in a nutshell. Number one, for getting knowledge, there are some sources as per the shastras. One is curiosity. Second is the need. Third is the exposure of persons. Fourth is revelation. It is the curiosity of each and everybody that drills inside a person, tempts a person to go for more knowledge. A person being curious, he gets one observation, that observation gives one input. The input, if it is considered and proceeded, that becomes knowledge. Otherwise, it becomes just your vague experience. So first of all, it starts with curiosity. It is a persistent curiosity, directed and targeted curiosity, obedient and systematically organized logical curiosity. Second is need. Whenever your person is crushing his own mind for need of something, naturally the inner doors will be open so that the realization can be automatically brought out. Third thing is exposure. Already experienced various other inputs that he is having in his mind, whenever he is assured with that of the expansion of the society, his exposure will have a natural elasticity which will wind up its own previous stage and gives us more scope and hope for knowing some more things in the same depth, in the same direction, in the same direction or in the same dimension. So first of all, curiosity. Second is need, which brings everything. In one science seminar, somebody told, curiosity is the mother of all inventions and necessity is the father of all inventions. Necessity is the mother of all inventions. Innumerable various definitions have been given. That's why I told in that the parentage of science can be explained like this. No doubt necessity is the mother of inventions and curiosity is the father, but danger is the daughter of all inventions now. So this is the parentage of modern science. So in this particular angular view of interpreting the reality of science, I want to say the fourth thing as a revelation, apart from curiosity, need and also exposure of a person, revelation is an intuitive drive. Apart from what you are getting from outside, the shastras, as well as even apart from that of what you are getting from outside, there is a natural, parallel, intuitive inbuilt which has a resemblance of what you are saying now, what you are saying now, what you are reading now. Whatever you say, whatever you see, it has already an inbuilt pre-configured system inside, and whatever you get from outside is a reminder. And this type of getting this knowledge is known as revelation. Just as the coverage of various other murky sheets of mud is revealed while digging, whenever a person is going on for the process of digging, the murky cover of the earth's crust is removed so that the water that is already hidden inside is revealed. Like that in polishing of a gem also, the luster, the resplendence that is hidden there already, that is being revealed by a polishing process. So nothing that which is not existing is going to be revealed by means of a process. Each and every process, according to science, it is an addition. According to spirituality, it is a revelation. It is a reminder of what you have gone already with in your imprints, in your instinctive drive, in the time immemorial incorporation of the spiritual infinite resplendence of divine consciousness, which is embedded inside you inseparably. It is a natural drilling process. Number one, each and everything is brought only by exercise. Even you possess something, you have to go for exercise. That particular exercise that we are going to do, that creates a person's knowledge depending upon the tools that he takes. It may be a string, it may be a spring, it may be a stream, it may be a flow, it may be a flood. In despite of each and everybody's movements, still a person is having a balance. On the basis of the balance, the tools and the other guiding elements, he can get any amount of knowledge. This starts with observation. We also observe the same thing which Newton observed. We are also observing same thing that Jagadish Chandra Bose has observed. But that was attentive observation, intensive observation, incessant observation, correlative observation, formative and formulative observation, and depictive and executive administration, by which his imagination or his observation has been brought into a proper way. So this observation which comes from science, why I am saying this thing is, these things, how science manifests. See, scientists can make innumerable things, but only spiritual wisdom can make proper scientists, real scientists with a long run vision. So I am now teaching you the process of incubating scientists, not scientists incubating products which are not having proper long run. They are just adversities hidden in the disguise. It is just like Ravana having come in the form of his sannyasi in Srimad Ramayana. All of these new inventions, they are menace, disaster, and the total disorderly abnormality of the society has come in the disguise of benefiting the society. To clarify this, to put a real concrete structure for that, in order to bring the realistic, eternal and perennial source of supply of happiness, health and harmony, which are the real essential fruits of the society, we need a spiritual background. That's why I am saying, this observation, unless it is guided by a proper way of a potential channel of a divine resplendence, or the splendor of the clemential and potential shower of the ultimate spirit, who is an embodiment of immaculate consciousness, it is not easily possible for any person to imagine even about the true and fruitful wisdom. So here I want to say, just a regular process of observation resulting in comprehension, comprehension resulting in analytical study, then scrutiny, vision, broadening the vision, deepening the vision, which will result in hypothesis, thesis, antithesis, synthesis, concept theory, science, engineering and technology. This is the hierarchy of evolution of knowledge in epistemology in the scientific domain. This should be properly guided by a parallel flux energy, a pivotical energy which is known as spiritual blessing. On this basis, there are three sciences. One is the subtle science, and second is the structural science or super science. Third thing is known as the salient science. What is subtle science? That deals with your liberation, deals with personal identification, deals with your own happiness, tranquility, living peacefully with everybody, and resulting as a total survival of the wholesome society in bliss and eudaimonic endeavor. That is known as subtle science. Second thing is salient science, which deals with biology, which deals with astronomy, astrophysics, evolutionary cybernetics, neurology, pathology, innumerable sciences, everything which has clearly told by somebody as apology, all other ologies, they have a common name. Just as we have innumerable parts inside the body, but there is a common name known as the body. Whatever may be the innumerable parts are there, inner parts, innermost parts, then outer parts, innumerable parts are there, they have a composite name known as body. All the ologies have a common ology, common name known as apology. That is a composite nomenclature of all sciences. So these sciences that deals with various other things of mechanics, mechatronics, electronics, metametrology, innumerable divisions of sciences, but they are all known as salient sciences. Special sciences are sciences that are dealing with economy, political engineering, social engineering, cultural studies, anthropology, interreligious harmony, interfaith dialogue, intercultural, cross-cultural relations. So these sciences, they have to unite and work with together. It is a Trimurti. It is a Trimurti Tattva of sciences. Wherever you see science, it should be cooperative and coordinative. There should be a triangular mutual understanding and mutual execution that lies between the subtle sciences, salient sciences and special sciences. So everything is understood by your mind. Everything is understood by you. So unless you know who you are, what is the use of understanding everything else? So the science of mind. Number one, which has understood everything? Mind. Which is going to promote everything? Mind. Which is going to properly use everything? Mind. Which is not going to use it properly? Mind. Which is going to destruct everything? Mind. Who is going to prevent the destruction? Mind. So everything is mind. If the science of mind is not read, if the application of mind by means of a theopsychological or a theo-antopsychophysiological coordination, this quadrilateral identity is not understood, the study of any other science is futile. It is sarvam hutam bhasmani. It has no use at all. So here only we want to say, what is the contribution of the Indian literature to the modern trend exclusively, irrespective of the person's caste, clan, originality, linguistic and various other barriers. So this is where we are going to end. So mind has two abilities. One is intellectual ability, second is ethical ability. What should be that? Intellectual ability is the capability of a person to know, analyze, to deepen, to forward, to formulate, to synthesize, to apply, to distribute. Everything is intellectual ability. To give, to share with people, to enjoy, to see others, sorrows and to be sorrowful, that empathy and sympathy, everything is on the basis of ethical ability. They should go together like a rail of a train. They are parallel and they should be just going on very parallel. It is very essential. This both of the abilities should be there. This ethical ability that prevents four things. Why there is problem? Not because of intellectual ability. Not because of intellectual ability we are suffering. We are more suffering because of lack of ethical ability. Ethical ability deals with four things. Number one, non-distribution. Second thing is distribution. Third thing is discrimination. That is also that. Discrimination is a problem. Fourth thing is the destruction. Number one, what is distribution? Wealth is meant for distributing to everybody. You are not distributing it. It is held on by somebody else. That is the reason for the recession. I have attended and organized three seminars on recession. Special economic zones and IT administration. Recession is not due to lack of funds or due to paucity of wealth. It is due to the obesity of wealth which is unorganized, implementing the society. Over wealth only results in recession, not to lack of wealth. It is being stagnant in somebody else's private sanctum sanctorum. It should be brought out. So, wealth is meant for distribution. You are not distributing it. That is non-distribution. Second thing is, you should prevent poverty, unemployment, other things. You are distributing it everywhere. So, preventables are distributed. Distributables are prevented. What is that? It is ethical fallibility. It is ethical imprecision. We have to overrule that. Third thing is destruction. Everything is used whenever it gets into power blocks. All agents who are non-state reactors, it goes for destruction of the society. Fourth thing is discrimination in gender, race, and various other conflicts of the society. So these two types of ability, we have to concentrate only on the Vedas. But everybody is saying to concentrate on Vedas. What is the next step? See, whenever you want to eat something, immediately you purchase the product, clean them, then put into your proper usage and methodology of cookery, then taste the pudding. But whenever you talk about something in spiritualism, it is just like a pudding that is seen in photos or that is seen in video movies. So it becomes just something which is in a recreative experiment, not as a product which is to be experienced. So that is the problem with that. We have to institutionalize that and create that thesis. So first model theory is the theory of the Vedas. What is first model theory? There are three model theories. One is pre-operative model, second is post-operative model, third is parallel model. Pre-operative model, they say that before getting into intellectual ability, you should be very careful. After becoming intellectual, nobody will be interested in ethics. So you create a foundation of ethics, then give him the knowledge of intellectual expansion. That is pre-operative. Second thing is, you know that now you know when to take. Whenever you put something in the oil, you know the exact time of taking. Even if you delay or a pre-checking, advanced checking will spoil the taste or the nutrition of the substance. Like that, we must be very clear about the timing, the periodicity, the tenure, the inclination and proclivity of each and everybody who is to be subjected to our knowledge, dispersion or transmission or disposition. They should be very properly selected. Parallel thing is, you have to simultaneously feed, just as a coffee chicory blend, you have to simultaneously feed them with ethical and intellectual abilities. The third thing is now, adult people are well grown, now they are teaching mature people, timeless people, aimless people to behave good. How these timeless, aimless, mature and disobedient people can behave good? It is totally impossible. So this goodie generation, to make them goodie generation, you should have a very great power to do that. Or you should have a plan to do that. What is a plan? Do it at the early impressionable, immature age. That is plan. What is power? You develop your spiritual power so that irrespective of any age, they can be brought under your control. So you should develop these things. That's why I told you in a terrorism seminar, to take a person and to convert them to a terrorist so that they can kill themselves in self-suicidal bombs, also kill 100 people, it will take them just 3 months of training. But to make them corrigible and sociable, you have to take 10 years of classes, that too in vain. Because the patriots, they speak from their lips, whereas the terrorists, they teach from their hearts. They reach the heart of the people, whereas these people reach the brain of the students. So it is a lip-brain conversation in patriotism and nationalism. It is a heart-to-heart, mind-to-mind, deeper implantation in terrorism. That is the success story. So you follow terrorists, at least in the methodology of teaching, not in their execution. first one is really says that there are a lot of things, problems in our society. They are known as corrosion and erosion agents. What are the corrosion and erosion agents? First thing is laziness. Second thing is negligence. Third thing is disobedience. Weakness, physical weakness. Even though somebody is desirous to do that, those who are physically strong do unwanted things. Those who want to do wanted things, they are unfortunately physically weak. So they should be strong also, having a sturdy body also. All of these things are known as corrosion agents. And envy, avarice, hostility, hatredness, all of these things are erosion agents. So we have to see how to prevent these things. There is a methodology in Shastras. They consider all entities and all characteristic features as convertible and investable. For example, you are having a fear. If you invest the same fear in your education, in your productive methodology, that fear will be an additive to your education. But that methodology is an alchemical methodology, not chemical methodology. Chemical methodology of fear is diluting your ability and confidence to study. An alchemical, spiritual, special methodology is to convert the same fear, convert the same greed, convert the same enthusiasm you are having, convert the same type of envying others, prejudicial view on others, as a healthy competitive spirit by which you can get more marks. So this conversion is only by spiritualism. Convert all good characters into bad characters is the modern wisdom. Convert all other unwanted things, just as you are doing waste recycling. Waste management. You waste this type of material waste can be recycled and managed in modern science. Why can't the paramaterial internal waste can be recycled and managed in our internal mechanism? So frequency is not only bringing out the energy, it is also the potential spirit of converting the wastages of the mind, the murky dirt of the mind, the dust of the mind, the useless reservoir of the mind which has very much inhibited and accommodated all unearthly and essential malicious agents that can be very potentially converted into a very great internal psychonuclear power, which is a very composite constructive power for the development of the society. This is the very great art of our land, wherein by we can make everything convertible, recyclable, and we can also use them for constructive purposes. That's why they say in Shastras that whatever you think as addictive and annihilative, by spiritual wisdom they can be converted into additives for your development. Addictives and annihilatives can be converted into. How it is possible? There are two glimpses of Indian wisdom I want to say. Number one, there is a triad. What is the greatness of Indian wisdom? Indian wisdom taught about something complete, something perfect. It dealt with three things. Number one, eternity. Number two is truth. Number third is universality. So as it has given you idea about eternity, you can easily manage. For example, a weightlifter can easily lift or he can blow a feather. Likewise, any person knowing, having deeper knowledge about the eternity, he can deal with ephemeralism. He can deal with the transience. He can deal with unsustainables. He can deal with unstables. So by giving the knowledge about eternity, it has made you to understand and operate everything with ease which are below eternity. Understanding truth, you can understand what is pseudo truth, what is infra truth, what is mega truth, what is meta truth, what is para truth, what is supra truth, what is disruptive truth, and what is a partial truth, and what is a division of truth. Everything, whatever may be in the form of part and parcels of the composite truth, you can very immediately understand those things because you know the truth. Third thing, if you know about the universality, you can easily organize your personal resources as well as your provincial resources, resulting in social harmony, domestic harmony, in national development. Everything can be done. So understanding the three basic factors of the creation, universality, eternity, and truth, we can understand everything. That is the first benefit. Second thing is stipulative exercises. By executing, we get benefit. That is known as the rotary kinematics and applied energetic science in dynamism. And second thing is, by restricting, you get more power. See, if you love wealth, you can get wealth by your hard work. This is one dimension. This is known as positive procuration dimension. Second thing is negative accomplishment. If you hate wealth, hating wealth is not because of its non-availability. Hating wealth because of having attachment towards the superior wealth known as the divine blessings or divine union. Such a person, the same wealth will be at his feet to serve. It is known as ontoeconomics or theoplutonics in the Vedic studies, by which one can admire wealth and gain wealth. One can behave in such a manner so that he is fixed with a greater wealth system, so that wealth can admire and take shelter in his feet. So that is the greatness of our system. In this, there are some restrictive exercises like austerity, like celibacy. Whenever you control something, then you abide with nature. You have a power to rule. Only a person who has control has the power to rule. Only a person who can rule has the power to possess. only a person who can possess it will be very much happy even he possesses and not possesses. A person who can behave at the time of possession, at the time of over possession, at the time of a simple possession, at the time of secular possession, at the time of a fragmental possession, at the time of non-possession, at the time of adversity, at all times he can be happy, resourceful and guiding the society. And doing the sacrifices like yajñas, they develop lot of things like determination of the soul. Second thing is loss of your ego. Then loving everybody and increasing the bounty, being detached. Everything is only from the Vedic model. There are four models for the Vedas. One is a perspicacity model. Second is a tranquility model. Third is a prosperity model. Fourth is a liberty model. You can select anything. That's why I told in Shastra, somebody told, these Shastras, they prevent gaining wealth. So we don't want that. Then all Shastras have given three models. One, if you don't want wealth, then renounce it. I want only limited wealth. You go to contentment. There are three models. One is renunciation model, contentment model and charity model. I don't want any wealth at all. Yes, renunciation, you go to that room. And the second thing, I want wealth to my level. You go for contentment model. Yes, I want to get more wealth. Go to the charity model, distribute with everybody, be happy. So Vedas are made for everything. Perspicacity model is to gain knowledge. Prosperity model is to gain wealth. Tranquility model is like the ascetic life in which we get mental peace and rest. And liberty model is to be emancipated from the world. What is the wisdom? Wisdom is entirely different from knowledge. Wisdom has no connection with knowledge. Knowledge has no connection with the teaching. Teaching has no connection with syllabus. Syllabus has no connection with the school. School has no connection with the teachers. Teachers have no connection with the students. This is the present model which is emerging in various schools. It is the detachment model, it is the sannyasa model of the society now in the education system. And how to link all of these things? Only people who are the earmarkers of heritage, who are the worshippers of heritage, who are the battalion of the gods, the divine wisdom army, only they have to take this charge and launch this issue. What is wisdom? I want to say in the brevity. Number one, wisdom is the art of compression. Reading lot of books, everybody can read. But to compress and reproduce whenever required, that is an art. Nobody is having that art nowadays. It is just going the way of perishing. So first is the art of compression. Second is, somebody told wisdom means we have to know everybody. No, no, no. Wisdom is not knowing everything. It is the ability to know anything at everything at any time required. So it is the ability to know, not that we must have everything in the finger, tongue and brain tips. Not like that. So first is compression. Second is ability to know things. Third is having vigilance and confidence. That is the third power required. And the fourth power of knowledge is ability to do. Fifth power is ability to hold. That is a memory power or cognitive skill. Sixth thing is to adapt any circumstances. Recession, war, poverty, disharmony. In spite of any other inconvenience in national, society and domestic level, one has to survive. That is wisdom. Otherwise, it is just merely uploading something like a computer disk which has no value in life at all. Lively wisdom, it can adapt all circumstances. Adaptation of circumstances is a very great skill of wisdom. All of these things are known as skills of wisdom. And what is the difference between wisdom and knowledge? I want to say a few points. Number one, wisdom experience. Whereas just a mere exposure to society and doing some other peripheral work is known as knowledge. And realization is known as wisdom and mere memorization is known as knowledge which we are doing now. So it should have some taste of joy, it should have ease and comfort. These are all the various benefits of wisdom and knowledge. Now, how to promote this knowledge into wisdom will be dealt in a very big seminar which is exclusively meant for that. Not only because of paucity of the time, but also by the intensity of our desire as well as the intensified mechanism of widermost things that are hidden in the deep abysmal core of this knowledge. It requires dates of discuss and months of practice and years to go for penance for achievement. So number two, like we are getting, that's why somebody told, knowledge is given but wisdom is gained. Wherever we teach something, I am speaking here. It is just given to you. But if you operate it inside your inner mind and get the benefits of same thing, so the first step is known as knowledge. Knowledge is the next step to ignorance, whereas wisdom is the previous step to success or attainment. Wisdom is the previous step to success or attainment, and knowledge is the next step to nescience or ignorance. That's what they have clearly told about these things. And whenever we come to various other things, we have to understand different tempers already, because we are doing a working project on Brayas, breeding of young scientists. Oh, we can breed young scientists, like they are breeding with the crocodile farm, snake farm, everything they are doing except for human beings, and for talented human beings, and human beings, except this, everything is bred on our endangered species. The first endangered species are a real, valuable, noble, humble human being is the most endangered species. Why we are not doing that? That we have to concentrate more. So, breeding young scientists, there are 7 temples. I want to say something. One science seminar I addressed, everybody started off not conducting the seminar henceforth or not calling me henceforth for the seminar. Number one, there is innovative temper. Second is creative temper. Third thing is imitative temper. Fourth thing is adaptative temper. Fifth is operative temper. Sixth is inceptive temper. Seventh is deceptive temper. Indian science or whatever you call, most of the things are imitative, adaptative and operative. Innovative intelligence and creative intelligence is very less in India. No doubt we are proud of few scientists like Chandrasekhar, Raman and other people. But that is totally insufficient. So we are taming people who can work for the development of other countries and other technologies, and we are just having a pseudo pride that we are developing in science instead of thinking that we are developing somebody else at the cost of our sacrifice and services. And we are not realizing that. These 7 tempers are there. Once we have to conduct a seminar on education about methodologies and ancient tools for developing innovative and creative intelligence, we have to work at all. And there are 2 divisions of education. One is conceptive history and expansion. If you read about the conceptive history of the previous inventions, inventors and various other things, you have to get into expansion by means of 3 types of learning. One is relearning, second is unlearning, third is learning. So these arts are not there. How to relearn the thing so that it can be stamped? How to learn the thing properly? See, to read is different from studying. To study is entirely different from learning. To learn is entirely different from realizing. To realize is entirely different from relishing. To relish is different from attaining. To attain is different from distinguishing. These type of various hierarchies of knowledge should be properly understood. Only this is possible by Vedic wisdom. So these 2 phases of conceptive history and expansion of the conceptive history into contemporary studies and futuristic expansions that can be made possible only by these unlearning, learning and relearning techniques. Education requires 3 instigatory methods. One is interest. Second is involvement. Third thing is identity. I'm interested in studying this. This is my interest. I am totally studying only this. That is involvement. I am not separable. I am not feeling myself somewhat different or distinguishable from this content. I am identical. This is possible in cinemas. This is possible in cricket shows. This is possible in all the other filthy unwanted exercises. In all the unwanted things, identity is there. Unless the person is identical with the knowledge, with the syllabus, with the teacher, with the spirit of wisdom, they cannot get real knowledge. It is only a daydream for everybody. So they are getting, even interest is lacking now. How to say about involvement and identity, characteristic identity and conceptive identity, how you can get these things? Huh? It is just miraculous. Normal incidental achievements have become very miraculous now. So how to get this? Because the Shastras say very simply, if you are attached towards the cinema, cricket or any other attraction, any other peripheral, ephemeral, infra and structural alluration, wherever you are attached to, why it is happening and why it is happening in ephemeral things or filthy things, why it is happening in education, realization and advanced things. The Shastra says that whenever you want to go to something which is filthy, it is downward motion, it does not require anything because there is a natural gravity of attraction towards inferior and filthy sources. If you want to climb superior, then it requires a compression. It should come from you or from your model, a radiant model of a teacher, a spiritual saint or a very great committed person from a society. That should be a role model from the society. Living role model, loving role model, deep-hearted, deep-rooted, deep-seated role model should be there inside you. Then only you can get all of these benefits. So, what is this? Why we are calling this a school and what is the purpose of this education syllabus? Education is the art to educe a person's inner craving for knowledge in the form of interest to mature into the process of involvement and to fructify into identity is the work of a school. That is why there is a system made, there is a structure made. It starts with everything 6 S we used to call it as. One is a place where there is environmental conduciveness, where you can develop interest into involvement and identity. That environment is known as a school. And the particular discipline where you are going to focus, that is known as a syllabus. And the particular area where you are going to cover is known as a subject. And the methodology by which you will be examined, experimented and you will be uploaded with the knowledge, that is known as system. And the person who is going to do that is a scholar, the receptacle is known as a student. So, this type of ideology of getting the involvement and identity from mere interest has resulted in the form of school, the subject, the syllabus, the system, the scholar and student. It is the real birth, or it is the Janma Kundali of the school technology or the school methodology which is available now. This is the proper way of understanding that. What is the difference between present system and previous system? In previous systems, we were having four people: Acharya, Shishya, Vidya and Jnana. Now we are not having those things. Acharya is different from a teacher. Shishya is different from a student. Vidya is different from syllabus or subject. Jnana is different from knowledge. Entirely they are different. What is the capability of an Acharya? Acharya has few capabilities. Number one, an Acharya has a distant influence capability. From the house he can command. Now even before the classroom he cannot command. So distant influence. Distant influence is the power of a spiritual master. And number two, a person who can be capable in doing two things. One is modeling, second is molding. You be like that, then make the person like that. That is modeling and molding the person. Then instigation and implantation of all of these things. Then without any speech, in silence and inertia, one who can conduct the classes, he is having the transmission authority, he is an Acharya. Acharya, by his vision, by his touch, by his remote wish, by his kripa drishti, by his clemential extension of optical or sensory visions and visuals, the person can deeply influence a person and bring him wisdom. That person is a very great person, and he should have also the capability of creating a bondage. He should implant the devotional attachment or preeti within the disciples. He should have the courage as well as the capability to create a bondage with the child till it is subjected to the funeral rites. So that is an Acharya. So Acharya has the powers of transmission, distant influence, implantation and instigation, modeling and molding, as well as creating a bondage. And second, Shishya. Shishya is a person who should have the quality of viewing. What is viewing? He must be just blank. Now the people, they are just blank. Even if everything is given, they are blank. They don't see anything at all. So now viewing is to view something in addition with what the teacher has told and what he has understood. It is known as imaginary engineering. He should be an imaginary engineer, number one. Number two, he should have trans-operational skills or trans-cognitive skills. He should not be just a bookworm. More than that, he should have the trans-cognitive skill. He should have also a contemplative and inspirational model. Whom he worships is known as a contemplative model, like Hayagriva or Vishnu Narayana. Inspiration model may be a very great scholar, saint, stalwart, or anybody available that. And a person should possess culture. What is culture? Culture is the expansion of human mind where he thinks and links about others when he is attempting to grow. Culture is defined as the art of expanding his mind. It is a magnanimity to think and link others in his process of growth. That is known as culture. And I want to say about one culture, ut, uttara and uttama. If you learn, if you get knowledge, that is ut. If you give knowledge to others, that is uttara. If you establish an institution where perennially knowledge is available to everybody relentlessly, that is uttama kritya. So the best culture is to establish an educational institution which can produce any number of people. Educational institution can produce God people, godly people, God-like people, God-sent people, and even produce God people, godly people, God-like people, God-sent people, and even God himself will come to the school. So that is known as uttama kritya as per the shastras. And what is the difference between vidya? Swamiji told, sa vidya ya vimuktaye, he should liberate us. Liberate us from outside problems, internal problems and inbuilt problems. Outside problems are disharmony, war and clashes in the society. Internal problems are avarice and other things. Then innermost inbuilt problems are being born again and again. Even that will be reduced. Even that will be extirpated in this course of knowledge. Real wisdom liberates you from all sins, from all problems, from all predicaments. That is the greatness of real wisdom. And also in the course of understanding jnana, what is jnana? Jnana is never fading and ever shining. It should assure you four things: sturdity, stability, success and solace. That is known as jnana, which are now spoiled and looted by modern education. The modern jnana lose these qualities which are bounded to be given by the same jnana. So this is known as jnana. This type of system does not exist in the modern system. So it requires a very great mega transformation and mega renaissance. Mere small renaissance cannot bring all of these issues. Then that is the greatness. What are the problems of this society? In the concluding remarks, I want to say, number one, at first knowledge is given by Maharishis. First M. Second, it was sent to masters. Second M. The third thing, it was sent to men. Now just human beings are teachers. Now men, 3M. Now it is sent to missions. Now everything is e-learning. E-learning, distant learning, you do SAT, then teleconferencing system, everything is connected and connected to machines. So it has come down from Maharishis to masters, masters to men, and men to machines. That is the problem of the modern society. So what is the thing? If knowledge is hard, there are two systems. Modern system says, if knowledge is harsh or hard to digest, arduous, you simplify that knowledge. But Vedic knowledge says, if knowledge is hard, it is hard only because of, for example, if I am not able to lift a mountain or a rock, that is the greatness of the mountain, not my weakness. If I am not able to lift this, this is not the greatness of the chamra, but it is the weakness of my heart. My hand is weaker than that. Could you follow that? For example, if a person is having structure in hand, if a person is having structure in hand, if he cannot lift anything, that is different. But if a person is having fracture in hand, he cannot lift his hand itself. Then we can say, think about other things being lifted by the hand. He cannot lift his hand itself. Shastra says that if you are not understanding, if you are not able to overcome the hurdles of education, that is not the problem inbuilt inside the education, but inbuilt inside your ability to learn and to retain. So the Veda says, amplification is the process for understanding knowledge, whereas the science says simplification. Everything you do, computers, calculators, logarithm tables, now nobody can calculate. They are just dependent on calculators. This is the thing. Then the third thing is, the purpose of education is to serve poor people. There are three poor people according to Shastras. Those who are ethically poor, those who are intellectually poor, those who are financially poor. Only these people, they have to be supplied knowledge according to Shastras. Fourth thing, the Shastras, they deal with the relation between a spiritual master and a disciple. Now it has been, how degraded we can see. It started with reverence, then it became regards. Then it became respect, then it became just a relation, then affection, then just a friendship. Now it has become mockery, then resulting in hatredness and hostility, and there is now distance between a teacher and a student. How? For ethical imparting knowledge, there is a distance. Even for imparting the syllabus, there is a distance. There is very great vast cleavage between the student and the teacher now. Even between the students, student-student relation, they are known as abramachari and sahapatis. Even in the relation, now we are seeing futile competition. Lot of competitions were there, healthy competitions. Now there is futile competition, disastrous competition, unhealthy and useless competition. In there are other things which are not going to contribute for the person this thing. Even in the syllabus, now we are just having a burden inside the head as well as outside the head in the form of syllabus. So syllabus as well as the teaching, it requires some sort of renaissance and reformation. Now, number one, what they say is, it is unidimensional drill. It is not properly taught and it is very much focused on extra load. Second thing is cognitive load. Instead of making it lovable, it is made as a load. Instead of making it as a boon, it is made as a battle. Third thing, it is ill-organized inside the brain. For example, I have given one the challenge in school, which I told to Omayaji also. Within 6 months, any person can complete the MBBS without any spiritual incorporation or indoctrination. The eligibility required is 10th standard failed. It is easily possible, it is not a miracle. Because of ill-organizing the concepts inside the brain only, people are suffering. And most of the things are diluted and diverted by socio-domestic factors, which are there alluring the people to concentrate on something else or to be totally impotent. These things are to be totally eroded, by which a person can get the real mastery, the real skill of learning each and everything can be very easily possible. And at least for experimentation, one or two people should come. And when I am asked how I am going to do this thing, 5 years of education in 6 months, they told it is surprising. I told it is more surprising why you are teaching 6 months of syllabus for 5 years. And it is not a joke. There is no practical proof for the divine intelligence or an organized intelligence. At least if you believe it, experience. If you don't believe it, experiment it. At least I think that some educational institutions should come forward in making this project a real success. This is number one. And number two, in various other things, there are certain criticisms for each and everything. Number one, old model theory. This education syllabus of Vedas is old model. Can it be applicable now? Number two, purpose variation theory. The purpose of the Vedas and Vedic period, they are entirely different. How we can adopt these things? Number three, Western knowledge theory. Western knowledgeable people, they are having beef and beverage. And they are totally against our rules and they are anti-ruling system. In our observations and practices, they are not having celibacy or any other control like that. Have they flourished or not? economically, great thinkers were there, great think tanks were there, great scientists were there, how they come. And Indian also, Indian system also, lot of people, thinkers are there and developments are going on without this thing, how it is possible. Fifth is a very big challenging problem. There is a car which is in repair, there is no driver, there is no road, there is no fuel, there is no mechanic and there is no workshop. How we can make that? Likewise, if you want to bring divine wisdom, who is going to bring that divine wisdom? What is the surety that the wisdom is not a partial divinity but absolute divinity? How there is a proof for a person's miraculous divinity by which he can incorporate that blemishless wisdom? So we have to get good students, we have to get good environment, we have to get good scholars, we have to get Subhamurta. But there is only one proof for everything that is the service of God, there is a pre-sanctioned blessing of God. For everything which is God's work, there is a pre-sanction. We are seeing Imittani Chapashyami, Viparitani Keshava. That was in Bhagavad Gita. Even in spite of seeing the Viparita Nimitta, Tatrashri Vidya Bhuti Dhruva Vyati Mati Mama, he was successful. Whereas we are seeing Imittani Chapashyami, Anukulani Keshava. We are seeing lot of other encouraging and developing, enchanting, empowering lot of women we are seeing. Certainly I believe that it is going to happen, and today, more than the Founders Day, it is a foundation day for this divine intelligence, I want to say. Then only the Founders Day becomes more fruitfully founded, or it is re-founded by us in its real sense. So, we want to establish all of these things, for which we take some of the special exercises. What are the special exercises? Number one, what is spiritualism? It is number one, spirit. To understand the inner force is known as spiritualism. Number two, understanding the soul is known as spiritualism. Third thing is specific spiritualism on the basis of particular doctrine or religion, everything is spiritualism. Number two, whenever you talk about spiritualism, it specially sees knowledge as something different. It sees according to spiritualism, what is knowledge or what is wisdom? Knowledge is happiness. Knowledge is meditation. Knowledge is pregnancy. Knowledge is creation. Knowledge is a sport. Knowledge is worship. Knowledge is service. Knowledge is a treatment for ourselves. Knowledge is a treat for our soul. A developed soul's treat is knowledge. Underdeveloped soul's treatment is knowledge. Love is knowledge. Bliss is knowledge. And value is knowledge. If you understand this knowledge in this method, knowledge will be at your doorsteps. It will be ready for your disposal. Instead of you disposing the knowledge after learning it or even before learning it. So instead of getting into the pathetic condition, we can get this type of knowledge which is more basic. So somebody asked me, why scientists are born in the West? How it is possible? Even scientists like Jatabharata, he was a very great rishi. Why he was born as a deer? Because of the over-concentration towards a subspecial standard. Likewise, those who are born here, those who had already previous worship towards God, because of their inseparable attachment towards modernism and materialism, the same people have been made to be born in the West. So, innate and inhibited. There are two types of blessings. Western people let them have innate blessings. We can have inhibited blessings towards science. We can achieve, if you achieve God, which is known as prajnana, you can achieve knowledge about yourself, that is samjnana. You can achieve knowledge about the world, which is known as vijnana. So everything is under our control, that we have to properly organize, which we have not done in our earlier systems. So for that, what we are going to do now, number one, vegetarianism, alcoholism, then smoking and various other systems in the society. Your person, there are two things. One is your person's exercises for hinder your exercises to promote your purity, sanctity and divinity. So this is very much according to our Shastras. Swamiji referred, Ahara Shuddhau Satta Suddhi Satta Shuddhau Dhruvasputi Smriti Lambe Sarva Granthi Naam Vipramoksha. So our basic thing is we should be very much careful in our observations. And anybody saying that I am not like that but yet I am knowledgeable means you have lost your quota, additional quota by your wrong practices. For example, if you have got 100 units of knowledge in spite of your non-vegetarianism and alcoholic affection, if you have abandoned those things, still you are having an opportunity to get more knowledge. Number two, we have developed Medha. There is Vagdevi Sukta, there is Medha Sukta, there is Vachaspati Sukta, there is Vagdevi Upasana, there is Hayagriva Bulavantra Upasana, there is Suparna Vidya, there is Trisuparna Vidya, there is Hamsamha Vidya, there is a Gandharva Vidya which is mentioned about Hayagriva in Hayashura Upakhyana. Innumerable such exercises are there in the form of tapasya, asana, acharana, havana, pujana, bhajana. Innumerable simple and sturdy exercises are there we have to practice. For that we have to start at least an institute, and it must must be affiliated to a scientific research institute. A person is doing the same thing without mantra. Amantrita, samantrita, abhimantrita, samabhimantrita. We have to classify the people, those who are not with the guidance of mantras, with the guidance of mantra, with inculcation of mantra, strong practice of the mantra, neurobiological as well as neuropsychological and chemical effects must be very properly scrutinized, experimented and tabulated by a scientific peer who should observe each and everything. What is the rate of differentiation and distinguishability of his caliber? What is there special in his acumen? What is there in his dexterity? So dexterity control, evaluation of acumen, evaluation and assessment of a person's sharp acumen, caliber and dexterity should be implemented by means of a scientific study. Now the society or whatever we are seeing now, they are not so much cooperative. We have to create our own environment. Because the political environment, the Shastra says that there are four people who are responsible people, four G's I want to say. One is the God, second is the government, third is the great people, fourth is the good people. Great people should induce the good people and government to take care of the great people and nourish them. And God should create a balance between all of these people. Good people should develop into great people. Great people should form the government and the government should serve God and his subjects. This is the real way of good governance. And unfortunately, we are not having that. Only possible way of getting these four G's in balance is to develop the education system. Because the starting of every life, the ending of every life, the fruit of life is education. So with the education only we can do that. Now we are into the vicious circle of improperty of knowledge. We have to operate the giant, mega, magnificent, benevolent wheel of the harmonious circle of divine wisdom instead of the improperty which is there in the vicious circles of knowledge. We have to use the missile of knowledge. Knowledge is not a pillow by which we can take rest. It is a missile. It is a powerful and potential tool which can bring back the reality of honesty and love in the society. For that, what we have to do is very simple. We have to induce. Let us start with a very small effort. Let us start with a single step. And instead of starting something new, the existing infrastructure, the existing persons. That's what I told in one seminar. Somebody asked how to do that. There are three things available. One is avapta dhana, second is anupura kshetra, third is abhimata jana. We need not go for more wealth. Whatever you are having, at least 10 pennies, use that. That is avapta dhana. You need not go for making the same thing in Islamabad or in Taliban region. You can do it in your anupura kshetra where you are having your own support. And you need not change people who are incorrigible. There are people who are available for your service, abhimata jana. With avapta dhana, anupura kshetra and abhimata jana, we can create the dawn of this society, and that is the duty entrusted by God to us. And let Somaya Vidya Vihar can concentrate on this Vidya Vikar that exists in the society. And let it bring back peace and harmony in the society. And whenever it is supported, naturally whenever a person thinks good, he will be fascinated by God, by which God creates association, resources, sturdity, development opportunities, utility of opportunities, being even born back again to continue. Yoga Bhritto Abhijayate. God gives all provisional gadgets that is required for achievement, provided that without having any intention for fame, for personal profit and development, anybody sincerely thinks that I wish and bless that the institution should take a lead in the society to bring back the rule of God. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.